Yes, my dear students, good morning to all. We'll be starting with a new topic, that is mutations. Already we have been aware about it. So can you see this picture? This is a chromosome. This part, which is represented with the blue color, the nucleotide base sequence, it is deleted. This is a deleted area resulting in shortening of the chromosome after deletion. So today we are going to talk about mutations, which is very important topic for the examination point of view. Will be asked most commonly for the short notes. So let's look into it. What is mutation? Already we have discussed about mutation in detail. It is defined as a change in the nucleotide sequence of the DNA. This change can be gross, so that areas of the chromosome may be changed or may be deleted, or may be subtle with the change in one or two or more few nucleotides. As showed you in the picture, there may be chromosomal deletion as well. Not only with respect to change in the particular nucleotide sequence, there may be deletion as well. So nothing but the literal meaning says that it's abrupt, spontaneous. So it is prone to happen 1 in 10 to the power of 6 cell divisions. Look at the frequency. Individuals who are showing the changes, we call them as mutants, and the altered phenotype due to mutation, we call it them as variants, and agents which are going to cause mutation, we call them as mutagens. These are the terminologies one must know about it. Mutation which causes change in the base sequence of the gene is known as gene mutation or point mutation in a particular base sequence. Clear? The causes could be spontaneous or induced. Yeah, can you tell me the spontaneous cause of mutations, which you have already discussed in the previous chapter? Yeah, spontaneous could be due to mutations like point mutation. Example for point mutation, sickle cell disease, right? The frameshift mutation, or can be chromosomal mutation, or there may be unrepaired DNA replication errors as a defective p53 induced due to a person getting exposure to the ultraviolet A rays, B rays and gamma rays, which are used in the treatment of cancer. So these patients can be developing formation of pyrimidine dimers. They may be undergoing deprotonation or depyrimidation, or it can also lead to free radical generation, which could cause the damage to the DNA. So these are all about the induced mutations. Now let us see what are these mutagenic agents. We have already discussed about the physical agents, which are again UV rays, exposure to ultraviolet A, ultraviolet B. Ultraviolet A causes, yes, do you remember? Pyrimidine dimers, right? And ultraviolet B, it causes direct damage to the DNA. It causes unrepairable damage to DNA. Already we have discussed it. And gamma rays, they are going to cause irreversible damage to the DNA. These are some of the physical agents. And chemical agent, can you give an example? We have already discussed about it. Yeah, benzopyrene. Yes, the benzopyrene can also cause a chemical damage to the DNA by forming what? Adducts. I told you the chemical gets inserted into the DNA, resulting in DNA adduct formation. And there are certain oncogenic viruses which are going to cause mutation leading upon to the cancers. This methyl chloranthane, when it was injected into the mouse, it could develop some sort of solid tumors. So it is a direct evidence that some of the chemicals are carcinogenic, resulting in tumor generation. And human oncogenic viruses, like you must be aware of Epstein-Barr virus and human papilloma virus, hepatitis B virus, which is accounting for hepatoma, human papilloma virus accounting for cervical cancer and uterine cancer. You must be aware about HPV vaccine, which is given in the adult reproductive women, right? Do you remember? This HPV vaccine is given for the adult population to prevent the future uterine cancer or cervical cancer. And Epstein-Barr virus, it is directly accounting for causation of Burkitt's lymphoma and nasopharyngeal carcinoma, which we'll be studying in detail in pathology. And effect of mutations. So what are these mutations actually? What level it can affect? It can either affect the RNA codons, that is mRNA codon, either it can affect amino acid sequence, or it can affect directly the protein function itself, right? So please remember at what level they cause different effects. That is RNA codon, amino acid sequence, or the directly the protein function. That means it is affecting the right translation, or it can affect the post-translational modification, right? Now, so the types of mutations are of three types: point mutation, frame shift, and chromosomal mutations. And what are the various mechanisms how these mutations exactly lead to the causation of the disease? There can be nucleoside, the nucleotide base pair substitution. Okay, adenine may be, you know, substituted with the cytosine, or adenine may be replaced with the thymine. That we are going to study. A purine may be replaced with another purine. A pyrimidine may be replaced with another pyrimidine. That we call it as translation. If a purine is replaced by the pyrimidine, then mutations of the nucleotide sequence itself. There is some deletion of, suppose you take an example, there is a deletion of U codon. There may be a deletion of guanine codon. So that is about the deletion and insertion. There may be some new base pair going to be inserted. So these are the various mechanisms how the point and frameshift mutations actually operate. Look at the substitution part of the example. If we discuss about that, this is adenine, cytosine, guanine and thymine. Suppose the adenine is replaced by guanine in mRNA, we call it as translation, right? If cytosine is replaced with to the thymine, we call it as translation, because purine is replaced by purine, pyrimidine is replaced by the pyrimidine. This we call it as translations. Right, this other type of mutation called transversion. Transversion, that means the guanine is replaced by the thymine, adenine is by the pyrimidine is replacing the purine. Here the pyrimidine is replacing the purine. Got it? So this is about the transversion. Now let's take an example of deletion. In the first diagram itself, I showed you the deleted part of the chromosome. There can be, you know, large scale deletions. The deletions may be of three different varieties. If it is a large area deletions, as we see that certain part of chromosome itself got deleted. You know, tell me an example for such kind of disease wherein the particular chain synthesis is only hampered. You look at an example of alpha thalassemia and beta thalassemia. Alpha thalassemia and beta thalassemia. In alpha thalassemia, as you all know that there is a deletion of alpha chain, and in beta thalassemia there is a deletion of beta chains, right? So the alpha deletions can be, you know, entire chain can be deleted, or some amount of the chain can be deleted, which is in the hemoglobin. You know that hemoglobin is made up of alpha chains and beta chains. What is alpha thalassemia? The alpha thalassemia is deletion of alpha chains. The beta thalassemia is deletion of beta chains, right? Yeah. Now, there is something called gene deletion that we have seen. And now looking into the other type of deletion, that is single nucleotide pair deletion. Let us take an example of CFTR sequence. This is nothing but cystic fibrosis transmembrane receptor gene. This is the sequence which has to be present normally. It is a nucleotide sequence ATC, ATC, TTT, GGT, GTT. This is the sequence which is present in the CFTR gene normally. Now look at the position called 508 position. What normally it has to be there, the amino acid phenylalanine has to be there. Are you getting my point? CFTR is a protein which is containing a gene sequence in this manner. It has got at 508 position, it has got a phenylalanine. Now, what happened, which has caused the deletion of the entire sequence, that is CTT, which is coding for phenylalanine. There's a deletion of it. The phenylalanine is deleted here. Now it is remaining with isoleucine, isoleucine, glycine and valine. At 508 position, there is a total deletion of phenylalanine. This particular deletion results in a disease called cystic fibrosis. This is something related to the transport. It is a transporter protein which is related to the chloride transport. Okay. So in this kind of patient suffering from the cystic fibrosis, we are going to measure something called sweat chloride estimation. There is a process called pilocarpine induced iontophoresis. This pilocarpine drug is given to induce the sweating in a patient suffering from cystic fibrosis to conclude the diagnosis. So once we give the pilocarpine, it induces a lot of sweat. The sweat collection is done with the help of a tissue paper, but first we are going to absorb the sweat with the help of tissue paper, and we are going to estimate the chloride content in the sweat. Okay, that is about the cystic fibrosis. So the mutation at 508 position due to deletion of phenylalanine results in what is called a cystic fibrosis. This we are going to study in future. Okay, this is about the single base deletion. This is a large chromosomal area deletion, and this is a single base deletion or the nucleotide deletion. Getting my point? And look at here. There's something called single nucleotide base pair deletion. Here there is a deletion of entire phenyl codon, right? Now here there's a single base pair deletion. There was cytosine in the parental DNA. The cytosine got deleted. It started from A, adenine. So this is one of the example for frame shift kind of deletion. Now look at an example for insertion. There's extra nucleotide which is going to be inserted here. Yeah. Now let's take an example. This is a mRNA which is a wild type. You can look at methionine, lysine, phenylalanine, glycine, then it is followed by UVA, the stop codon. Now what has happened at this position? The cytosine is replaced to uracil. Yeah, the cytosine base pair, it is replaced to the uracil. Instead of C, there is U. This is called as insertion. Getting my point? Can you please remember the example where we have given Huntington's disease or Huntington's chorea as an example for tandem repeats or nucleotide expansion disease, the triplet expansion disease? Do you remember where did we discuss about this aspect? Yeah, you can text me. Where did we discuss about triplet expansion diseases where we get the repeated tandem repeats of CAG repeats which we are going to get in Huntington's disease, and we have taken example for fragile X syndrome, CGG repeats we are going to get. So these are the expansion of the triplets. They say that in Huntington's disease the CAG repeats are somewhere around up to 300 repeats will be present in this patient suffering from this disease, CAG repeats. The clinical manifestation depends upon the number of CAG repeats. The more and more CAG repeats, this excessive CAG repeats will result in an abnormal protein, that is polyglutaminated protein. Getting my point? This is about the insertion aspect of the gene. Now let us look into the way what will happen now if there is a point mutation. What will happen if there is a frame shift mutation? So there is something called silent mutation. The name itself is indicating, even though this mutation is present, no disease manifestation, it is going to be silent. Missense and acceptable. Yes, there is some sort of missense mutation that is happening, but still it is acceptable to the life. And missense, partially acceptable. It's not completely acceptable, but doesn't mean that it is incompatible to the life. Patient is going to die. Patient is going to still survive, right? The severity depends upon the amount of chains that have been damaged. Now the nonsense, name itself is indicated, there will be nonsense codons coming and terminating in between the synthesis itself. Now let's look into silent mutation, an example. Silent mutation may change the codon, it will change the codon surely, but it is going to code for the same amino acid, because what did we discuss in the genetic code, which is explained by a concept called, yeah, can anyone tell me, if the amino acid is coded by more than one degeneracy of the codon or Obel's hypothesis? Remember here that the same thing we are going to discuss here. Normally there should be a codon for CUA. Okay, this CUA codes for leucine. Now there is a replacement of adenine to cytosine. That is, what kind of mutation, what kind of type of mutation here? Adenine is pyrimidine. That means it is a transversion. Getting my point? But CUC still codes for leucine. So there will not be any problem in a patient, right? Because leucine is coded by both CUA as well as CUC. This is called silent mutation. Next. Missense mutation but acceptable mutation. Now, look at an example for adult hemoglobin in the B chain. In the hemoglobin is made up of alpha chain and beta chain. In the beta chain, at 67th position, there was a codon called GUU. GUU will code for valine. Valine is a polar, it is a amino acid, again which is a branched amino acid. Do you remember? This valine is coded by CGUU normally at beta chain of adult hemoglobin at 67th position. This adult hemoglobin which was coded for the valine is replaced to GCU. That means uracil is replaced by cytosine. What kind of mechanism is this? Yes, pyrimidine is replaced by pyrimidine. It is a translation. This is going to produce a hemoglobin called as hemoglobin signi. The type of hemoglobin that we get it as hemoglobin signi. But patient doesn't have any problems. Okay, it is a type of mutation which is E. Okay, the homework is what is conserved mutation. All of you please going to tell me what is conserved mutation in the next class, or shall I tell you? Yeah, conserved mutation is nothing but suppose a amino acid is replaced by the another amino acid, it should have the same properties. Now valine and alanine, does they have same properties? No, definitely they are two different types of amino acid. Suppose aspartic acid is replaced by glutamic acid, is there any similarity between them? Yes, they are acidic amino acid. In that case, the properties of the particular protein may not be affected much because both are acidic amino acids. That kind of mutation we call it as conserved mutation. Remember this. Next. Missense, but it is partially acceptable. What is this kind of mutation which is really partially acceptable, which is again not much incompetent to the life? Look at an example for sickle cell disease. At adult hemoglobin in the beta chain at the 6th position, it is having glutamic acid which is coded by GAG codon, right? This GAG codon is replaced to GUG codon. That means purine is replaced by pyrimidine, but GUG is going to code for valine. The polar amine plays non-polar amino acid. Look at the different properties of the amino acids over here. Glutamic acid is an acidic amino acid, which is a polar amino acid, which is replaced by valine, which is a branched chain amino acid, which is a non-polar amino acid. Thus, it is accounting for stickiness nature of the hemoglobin molecule. This is going to result in something called hemoglobin S, that is, which is going to cause sickle cell anemia or sickle cell disease. Now, missense, but highly unacceptable. If the patient has this kind of mutation, it is not competent to live. Definitely the death is written. What is that kind of mutation? In hemoglobin, adult hemoglobin, in the alpha chain, the distal histidine is coded by CAU codon. This is replaced to UAU, which is going to code for tyrosine, resulting in an abnormal hemoglobin called methemoglobin. So there is a formation of HBM, which is not going to be compatible with the life. Patient will have severe cyanosis because of the compromised oxygenation. Terminator codon mutation, nothing here, the codon is replaced by the nonsense codons like UAA, UAG, and the chain gets terminated. Getting my point? Next. Now, what are frameshift mutation? Reading the frame means the three consecutive nucleotides are read, like in a genetic code where we represent as a triplet codon. That is a reading of the frame. Frameshift mutation, it is due to addition or deletion of a basis. When this happens, when either addition or the deletion happens, what happens? There will be a generation of the abnormal protein, which is totally irrelevant, does not have any function, right? So insertion means there is addition of one or two nucleotide base pairs. Deletion means there is a loss of one or two nucleotide base pairs. So this is a frameshift deletion. You can see here the codon, that is a wild type of mRNA coding for methionine, lysine, phenylalanine and glycine, which is followed by the stop codon. Here the U is missing. One U is missing. There are two U's, uracil, uracil, followed by uracil and guanine. But here one U is missing, right? This is called as frameshift deletion. Now there's something called frameshift insertion. There's something called addition here. Look at an example here. Methionine, lysine, phenylalanine, glycine followed by the stop codon. After AUG codon, there is AAG codon. But here what has happened? There is extra codon here, that is uracil. This is called as frame shift insertion. Now, no frame shift mutation means number of nucleotide added or lost is a multiple of 3. So it is in the multiple of 3. There it is a single base. Here it is in the multiple of 3. One particular amino acid is going to be missed because 3 will code for particular amino acid, right? So now look at an example. AUG coding for methionine followed by AAG coding for lysine followed by UUU for phenylalanine. Here entire this 3 nucleotides are missing. AAG, lysine is missing over here. This is called as no frame shift mutation. Now consequences of point mutation, already we have discussed about it, that sickle cell disease, right? Now nonsense codons in the in between, and they are going to terminate the chain. Now the frame shift mutation can lead to even thalassemia, and due to premature chain termination, run on polypeptide that are non-functional. So this is in total about the mutation. Now we are going to move on to an interesting topic, just be connected. I need an answer from the students now. Can you see this picture? Yeah, I need an answer from you all. Tobacco plant, look at the beauty of this tobacco plant which glows in the dark. It was discovered in 1986. How did they do this? Yeah, come on. Yeah, they did transfer of a gene which was responsible for fire, and it was transferred to the tobacco plant so that it was able to glow in the night. The particular character of this gene, which is having got a tendency to glow in the night, has been transferred to this particular plant and glows in the night, right, in the dark. I need an answer for this question. All of you please be alert. A 45-year-old obese vegan, she is a vegetarian female patient, is suffering from uncontrolled type 2 diabetes for the past 10 years, for which she was on oral meds. Her laboratory investigations were showing fasting blood sugar 432 and PP 478 and HbA1c, that's called glycogen 0.6 milligram, definitely it is raised, and the blood urea was still normal, it was 32 milligram per deciliter. And the patient was having severe proteinuria, which is evidenced by the dipstick test, which is 4+, and urine PCR stands for protein creatinine ratio, was also elevated. Concerned physician advises her, madam, now it's your time to start insulin because you are not having any control on the, you know, the sugar cannot be controlled with the help of your anti-diabetic medication. Now it's the time to start our insulin. But the patient was highly reluctant. She was not happy. She don't want to take. She don't want to start insulin. Okay, she goes to the clinic and for the pharmacist, she buys insulin by convincing herself. After going through the literature of the insulin, she doesn't want to take at all. Yes. Can you please tell me what may be the reason? Waiting for the answer. Can anyone guess the answer? Why she was reluctant, not happy with this advice? Yes? So no answer. Because the source of insulin was from the pig. It was written in the literature, pork insulin was used in the treatment of diabetes. She doesn't want to use because she's strictly vegetarian woman, so she doesn't want to use this. So let the credit go to the technology called genetic engineering, which has solved this particular problem in this modern era. So today we're going to discuss about biotechnology or genetic engineering. Again, this can be asked for the main question. Let's see what is genetic engineering. It's also called as recombinant DNA technology, or it is also called as gene manipulation or gene cloning or genetic modification or new genetics. These are the other names of recombinant DNA technology. Now coming to the definition, nothing but just a process by which pieces of DNA have been taken from one organism, they are transferred into another organism. Suppose human DNA into bacteria, bacterial DNA into the plant, and human into the sheep, and fish into the plant, all that. Principle, there's a lot of manipulation and alteration of the genes that is involved in this entire procedure. So the process of artificially copying a piece of DNA from one organism, we have taken a DNA from one organism, DNA joining this copy of DNA into the DNA of the other organism. Matlab, we are bringing out two DNA insertions that call as hybrids. Nothing but DNA-DNA hybridization, right? Now, what's the basic principle of this technology? Now look at the diagram carefully. This is a circular DNA which is extracted from the E. coli. We call it as plasmid. Now, what are the markers of plasmid? How do we identify that yes, this is a plasmid and this is a double, circular DNA, double-stranded circular DNA which is taken from the E. coli. It has got some marker called as antibiotic resistant gene. It is a marker for the plasmids. If this gene is present, definitely you can take it for granted it is a plasmid. It's a marker of this plasmid. So we have taken a plasmid DNA and the circular double stranded DNA containing antibiotic resistant gene is cleaved by the restriction endonuclease. We just want a particular piece of the gene which is going to code for antibiotic resistance. Now the very, the major problem in clinical practice, especially in our India, antibiotic resistance. In spite of using multiple antibiotics, the bacterial infection, patients are not responding these days because we have developed a lot of resistance against the clinical practice. This antibiotic resistance gene is located on the plasmids of the bacteria. They are highly resistant to certain antibiotics. Okay, that will act as a marker of the plasmid. We have taken a gene, piece of DNA, which is coding for that particular antibiotic resistant gene. Getting my point? Because our interest of study is antibiotic resistant gene. We have taken that piece of DNA. Now, who is going to cut this DNA? There should be an enzyme called restriction endonuclease, which I am going to discuss in the next slide. With the help of this enzyme, they are also called as, yes, molecular seizure. So this molecular seizures, with the help of this particular enzymes, they are going to cut the DNA. We got a piece of DNA now. It's cleaved by plasmid. Now the DNA of the interest. In human beings, we take the same gene and which is being split by the same enzyme, same restriction endonuclease called ECAR1, because ECAR1 can only cut at that particular segment of the DNA. Now we got something called DNA of interest. The DNA to be amplified is cleaved by the restriction endonuclease, the same enzyme as that used on the plasmid producing complementary sticky ends. Getting my point? If the sticky ends are produced, they can join easily into the plasmid. Now this we call it as hybrid plasmid or chimera. What is chimera? It is a mythological monster which was described in the imaginary Greek lion's head and goat's body and serpent head. It has got a goat body. Two different animals are there here. Similarly here, two different DNAs are there here. We call it as hybrid plasmid. Getting my point? This hybrid plasmid is going to be inoculated or it's going to be inserted into a particular host cell which is having a clone. In vivo amplification of DNA. This is in vivo amplification of DNA which is happening inside the living cell. That is a bacterial cell. This is a bacterial DNA plasmid we are going to inoculate into the bacterial cell. Now bacteria has got a tremendous capacity to undergo replication, generating enormous amounts of hybrid plasmids. You can see here enormous amounts of hybrid plasmids are generated. It will be transferred to the agarose media, which is acting as a support media, culture media for this particular bacterial colonies. And we are going to separate later. We are going to incubate it in the agarose media and we are going to use what is called as, now we need our DNA of interest which is amplified several times. Okay, now the plasmids are cut with the plasmids are again, they are cut with the same endonucleases and they are going to separate the plasmids from the DNA of interest. Now we got enormous amount of DNA which we want to study or which we want to use for further research purpose. So this is called amplified DNA of interest. So generating multiple copies, large amounts. Now coming to the requirements, what do we require? It is as similar to as that of replication, but it is having in vivo, which is happening inside the bacterial host cell. We need something called restriction endonuclease, we need something called vector, and we need human genome of interest which we want to study basically. Now Now let this is again an important question, most probably asked for short notes. Restriction endonucleases, they are known as, the other name of restriction endonucleases are molecular scissors. In order to transfer a gene, we cannot insert entire DNA into the host cell. We want to just separate, you want to just choose, and we want to only separate that particular fragment of DNA which codes for a particular gene of our interest. If you want to study sickle cell disease, we can only study about that particular hemoglobin B chain gene, right? We did not isolate entire DNA for that. In order to transfer a gene, it has to be first selectively split from the parental DNA. So we want to get a particular fragment of DNA, so we need to cut it. This is job is done by restriction endonuclease. Werner Arbor was a scientist. He showed the certain enzymes of the bacteria. Certain enzymes of the bacteria, they are going to restrict the entry of pages in the host bacteria. Hence the name, why they are called as restriction endonuclease, because they are going to restrict the entry of pages into the host bacteria, hence the name restriction endonuclease. Now, how do we name this restriction endonuclease? Suppose if I take an example, the example E. cor 1. Now, they are named after the species. Here the species is E. coli, that is Escherichia coli. It is isolated from this Escherichia coli. And the strains of bacteria, the second portion R represent the strains of the bacteria. It is a RY13 strain. And 1 represents the order of discovery of the enzyme in the particular species. Thus, E. cor 1 stands for Eco, means Escherichia coli, which represents the species, that is your bacterial species. R represents a particular strain, and 1 represents the order of discovery of that particular enzyme in that particular species. Getting my point? This is how we are going to label or name the restriction endonuclease enzymes. Now, what is their mechanism? They are not point cut DNA at a specific sites itself. Where do they cut then? It seems in the literature there are about greater than 800 restriction endonucleases available till date. See, look at the beauty of restriction endonuclease and the advances in the molecular biology, to study. It's called a palindromic arrangement. Now you go back to the DNA polymerase, RNA polymerase, consensus sequences, Kozak markers. They had particular sequences to start or act as a markers, right? Similarly here, they are going to recognize something called palindromic arrangement. Now take an example of the letter. If I read from backward, it is madam. From backward to forward also, it is madam. Similarly, this kind of sequences is recognized by the restriction endonuclease enzyme. That we call it as palindromic sequence or palindromic arrangement. Let us look into that. Now look at the palindromic arrangement. GAATTC is 5 sequence, that is your PC. Similarly, if you read from the backward here, GAATTC, from 5 prime to 3 prime it is GATTCC, and from 3 prime to 5 prime it is CTTAAG. This is called as palindromic arrangement. This restriction enzymes, they will go and cleverly they are going to recognize this sort of palindromic sequence. Now once they have identified them, they are going to cleave them. The mechanism of breaking this particular is that the enzyme acts between guanine and adenine series and thymine and cytosine series. There's a cleavage at this point and there's a cleavage at this point. And these two points get separated, producing what is called sticky ends, like this. Now, this part is get separated, CTCCCTCGATG here, which got cleaved from this, and the other portion, GAGCTA. CTTAA, you can see the same sequence here. It has produced one sticky end. The other sticky end contains what sequence? Yes, AATTCACC. Okay, and in the other strand, we have got GTGG. When these two come together again, they have got a tendency to bind. These are called as sticky ends. They're easily, they can bind with each other without any problems here. It's nothing but to run backwards, inverted repeat sequences, the resultant DNA will have overlapping or sticky ends. When they come closer, they are going to get attached, right? This is about the sticky ends. The restriction enzymes will act by two different mechanisms. One is by producing stick, by producing blunt ends. Sticky ends, you understood. Now, what are blunt ends? There's a direct cleavage between here. There's a sequence called, and remember one thing, the restriction endonucleases can recognize 4 to 6 nucleotide sequences only, not more than that. 4 to 6 nucleotide sequences. Here you can see there are about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? Here you can see 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, these sequences they can recognize. In the blunt ends, there is sequence CG, CC, CC, GG. Okay, this is a cleavage done by the hemophilus 3, which is going to give rise to GG, CC, CC, GG. It's going to come blunt ends. The two hands are joined like in this manner. Okay, this is called blunt ends. So you can just look at this diagram. The cleavage at this time is going to produce blunt ends, and ECOR1, hind 3, they are going to produce sticky ends so that they can join together very easily. Next, the circle, this is a circular DNA, and this is a gene of interest. This is a portion of DNA which we want to study. The restriction endonuclease has acted upon it and it has produced something called sticky ends. And this is human DNA of interest. With the help of a restriction endonuclease, it has cut at the specific restriction sites. It has again produced sticky ends. There are sticky ends in the plasmid as well and here also as well. So they can bind close to each other. That we call it as annealing. There is a removal or the cleavage of the gene of interest from the plasmid, and it has produced something called sticky end. You can see here, and this is human DNA of interest, and we have cleaved it, and this going to go and stick to the sticky ends of the plasmid. Getting my point? And these together form something called, when the joining of these two, we call it as annealing process. And this, once they are joined, the further joining is done by the DNA ligase enzyme, and there is a hybrid plasmid containing both plasmid DNA as well as human DNA of interest. Now, the examples for restriction endonucleases are ECOR1, HIND3, TAC1, HPA1. This is the source of the enzyme. ECOR1 is derived from Escherichia coli, and HIND3 represent, it is derived from the Haemophilus influenza RD. TAC1 from the Thermus aquaticus. Where do we use this enzyme? Do you remember? It is used in a process called polymerase chain reaction. And HP1, it is derived from, in fact, Haemophilus para influenza. So these are producing sticky ends, and this is producing the blunt ends. Getting my point? So these are some of the examples for restriction endonucleases. So we have studied about restriction endonucleases. One requirement we have fulfilled. The second requirement for the recombinant DNA technology is vectors. Now, what are these vectors? Vectors are nothing but simply DNA molecules. These vectors will carry a foreign DNA fragment to be cloned. Their job is to take up the foreign DNA which is to be cloned. Getting my point? And they have got a capacity to self-replicate in an appropriate host cell. If the host cell appropriately fit is provided, they have got a self-replicating capacity. Now, in order to interview, we want to get human genome. Millions of copies of DNA of interest of the human gene we want. My gene of interest, suppose I want to study about sickle cell disease. The gene which is coded on mRNA, that is my interest of study. Now I want to do, in order to introduce human genome into the bacteria, the gene has to be first transferred into carrier known as vector. Directly I cannot insert the human DNA into the bacterial cell. I need something called a vector which has got a self-replicating capability provided into the host media. If the vector is very big, how can we inoculate or how can we insert into the bacteria? It is tough. So ideally vector should be having small in size, and it should possess only one endonucleocyte. If it is having many endonucleocytes, the enzyme itself goes use, and it should have only one endonucleocyte. Now, most commonly used vectors are plasmids, the other ones bacteriophages and cosmids. The cosmids, what is the speciality of these cosmids? They have got both the characteristic features of plasmid as well as bacteriophage. These cosmids are nothing but the plasmids which are going to contain DNA sequences called around 200 base pair sequences. We call it as cos sites. They are present in the cosmids, which are mainly they are concerned with the packaging of this lambda DNA into the page. Need not worry about it, but just remember that the cosmids are having a property of plasmid as well as bacteriophages. That's it. Next, what are some of the differences between the plasmids and cosmids? Plasmids are, by definition, it's a small extra chromosomal DNA present in prokaryotes. Cosmid is a hybrid. We are creating cosmid DNA by joining the properties of both plasmids and bacteriophages. So the composition only plasmid DNA, but here it contains both bacteriophage lambda as well as plasmid DNA. These are natural vectors and these are constructed vectors. And look at the difficulty that we are going to face with the plasmid. Can insert only 6 to 10 kilobase per length. The larger DNA molecule cannot be inserted in it. But whereas cosmids have got a capability to insert up to 45 to 50 kilobase per length. Getting my point? And transformation and efficacy, it is comparatively less when we compare with the cosmid. They have got highly efficient. Cost sites, I told you, they are the extra nucleotide sequences of about 200 base pairs, which are exactly present in the bacteriophages, not in the requirements and human genome of interest. Now let us go to the technology in proper. I hope you understood what are the requirements. We require what is called as restriction endonucleus because we want to cleave the particular segment vector. Where are we? Plasmids. So the vectors may be of three types: plasmid, cosmid and bacteriophages, depending upon the size of inoculation of their length. Suppose plasmid, they can incorporate only about 6 to 10 kilobase pair, whereas bacteriophages can incorporate about 35 to 40 kilobase pair, whereas cosmids, which is a combination of plasmid as well as bacteriophage, they can incorporate about a length of 45 to 50 kilobase pair length. And the third one is bacteriophages. These are the vectors and the human genome of interest. Now let us look into the procedure in proper. Now, what are the various steps? First, preparation of specific human gene. Oh, this is a laborious procedure again. The particular gene of interest present in the DNA, which is going to code for the hemoglobin B chain, because my gene of interest want to study about sickle cell disease. Okay. Entire the DNA, it's about, hemoglobin protein coded gene is about 1.6 kilobase per length. And it is very difficult to search such a tiny particle inside this. It's very difficult to, isolate a particular DNA fragment. So, suppose if I take an example of insulin. Insulin is secreted by beta cells of pancreas. Now, I want to study about insulin. I want to see, we know that insulin is made up of 51 amino acids. I want to know what is the, is there any differences between the, individuals with respect to insulin gene? Is there any codon replacement? Is there any amino acid replacement? I want to study my gene of interest, suppose if it is insulin. I know very well that insulin is produced by the beta cells of the pancreas. I told you first there is replication. Replication is then transcription, that is DNA is converted to mRNA. mRNA to protein. My study of interest is protein, which is insulin. And identifying a DNA in such a huge genome is very difficult. Now, what am I going to do? I am going to directly look for the mRNA insulin at the transcription level. I am going to isolate this mRNA from the beta cells of the pancreas. But I need DNA, right? I have mRNA with me, which is coding for the insulin. This mRNA can be converted to DNA. We have already studied in the very first class. What are the enzymes which are involved in conversion of RNA into DNA? Reverse transcriptase. By utilizing this particular enzyme, I can convert the mRNA into complementary DNA. Getting my point? It's easy to isolate mRNA rather than DNA. Now, I have converted mRNA into DNA. The preparation of chimeric DNA molecules. Chimeric DNA means I have plasmid, as well as on the plasmids, and we have obtained the sticky ends on the plasmid and the human genome. I am going to join both of them to create what is called chimeric DNA or nothing but hybrid plasmid or hybrid DNA. Then what am I going to do? I want several copies of DNA of interest. Now the cloning of chimeric DNA. After that, we are going to transfer the vector into the host. Who was our vector? Plasmid, which was containing hybrid DNA. I am going to transfer this vector into the host. Who is the host? Bacterial cell. Now, what's going to happen? Now, the host cell has undergone because once the plasmids enter into the host cell, I said you, they have got a self-replicating capability. They can undergo millions of copies of DNA they can generate. Now I got the gene of my interest. Insulin gene was my interest. I got a several copies of it. Okay? Several copies. Suppose you, if I want to manufacture or if I want to, you know, produce insulin itself for the treatment of diabetic patient, the protein itself, then I can get enormous copies of insulin over here. So the selection of colony having the desired gene. Then we are going to inoculate into the agarose plate, which is acting as a supporting media, and after that we are going to cleave the plasmids using the same restriction endonuclease enzymes. At the restriction size they are going to cut and they are going to separate the plasmid, and we are going to get millions of copies of DNA or RNA or protein, whatever is your interest. Getting? Now, so this is a circular plasmid DNA. With the help of restriction endonuclease, we have cut the portion and the human DNA, and there is a annealing procedure, and with the help of ligase enzymes, get enormous copies of the DNA molecules which are of interest, and the plasmids are again, they are going to be treated with ECOR1 enzyme and releasing many copies of DNA of interest. You can get the amplified DNA of interest. Okay, now. There is a particular process called methods of gene transfer, that means transformation. Methods of gene transfer is nothing but we have a hybrid plasmid with us. Hybrid plasmid means chimera, we have with it, chimeric DNA. Now I want to introduce into the host cell. How am I going to do that? There are several methods to introduce the plasmid DNA or hybrid DNA or chimeric DNA into the host cell. What are those different methods? One is transformation, other one is electroporation, and other one is conjugation. The fourth one is transduction. Then we have something called micro injection, and there's something called liposome mediated gene transfer. Now let us look into the individual aspect. The E. coli host cell is there. This is a hybrid DNA, the recombinant plasmid. I want to inoculate or I want to incorporate it into the host cell. Directly I'm going to inject it. That is called as transformation. Now we get a transformed cell. You can look at the diagram better here. Next is electroporation. By applying high voltage, when we supply the high voltage across the media, what happens? The vector or the hybrid plasmid DNA gets incorporated into the host cell itself, because it is going to open something called calcium channels, and there will be imbibation of this into the host cell. Getting my point? Imbibation of the hybrid plasmid into the host cell because of opening of the calcium channels. Next, this is transformation. The lysis of the donor cell, it will going to release the DNA into the medium. This is a recipient cell. The donor DNA is taken up by the recipient. There's something called conjugation. This is a donor cell containing the hybrid plasmid, and this is a host cell. So they form something called tube-like structure when they come in contact with each other, and they are going to transfer cell. The other method is transduction. This is a donor cell. The bacteriophage is going to infect the cell first, and it is going to, you know, cause the attachment of this bacteriophage with the DNA of the interest of the donor cell. The lysis of the donor cell, the donor DNA is packaged and it is released into the bacteriophage. Okay, it is going to be released into the bacteriophage, and it is going to, once it releases the DNA of interest into the host cell, it goes out. The donor DNA is transferred and the phage particle infects the recipient cell. So this is about the transduction. These are the various methods for transfer of the gene. The other important mechanism is liposome mediated transfer. We are going to use something called liposome, which have got a phospholipid bilayer, and inside which is a, okay, research is going on about the delivery of insulin via the liposomes, because most of the patient having less efficacy because difficulty with the subcutaneous, every time you need to prick. So they are trying to focus more on oral insulins and liposomal mediated delivery into the cells and all. Similarly, here the liposomes are used for the gene transfer. Now, so this is the overall procedure of the recombinant DNA technology, which we have already discussed. Now, coming to the applications, what are the applications of this? recombinant DNA technology. Now, to make insulin for the usage in the diabetic patient, because most of the patients, the source of insulin, they are not satisfied. So the genetic engineering has evolved with the, you know, lot of reproduction of, you know, insulin and the larger scale manufacturing of this insulin, because India is a diabetic capital of the world. We do require insulin in a larger amount, and patients suffering from the dwarfism, we need a growth hormone, which is again manufactured with the help of recombinant DNA technology. There are other proteins which are used in the treatment of infertility, like FSH hormone and recombinant blood clotting factors and cytokines, certain growth factors and monoclonal antibodies, which are widely used in the treatment of cancers and certain autoimmune disorders, and recombinant enzymes, recombinant HIV proteins for ELISA testing, and tissue plasminogen activator protein for the patient suffering from the stroke, that is cerebrovascular accidents. Now, these are some of the applications in the clinical practice, and for the preparation of vaccines, especially the human papilloma and hepatitis B vaccine, are manufactured with the help of recombinant DNA technology. Then to make plants resistant to disease like tomato mosaic virus, it causes a lot of damage to the tomatoes, and you know, so the gene, the recombinant DNA technology has come out with a beautiful, you know, improvement to prevent the damage of such kind of viruses. And to make pigs, cows and fish grow at a faster rate, and higher production of milk by the cows, and to make pigs with a less fat, leaner meat. So these are the some of the applications of the genetic engineering. And yeah, we are going to connect again by 3 p.m. So the homework is: what is ENCODE, what is CRISPR-Cas9, what is gene library, and what is linkage analysis. And please do read about gene therapy, which can be asked for a short notes or short answer. So please do read about it, and get back to me in the afternoon session. So we are going to start our class again by 3 p.m. So thus we have completed two topics for today, that is mutations. Again, they may ask you what are point mutations and what is the clinical significance of point mutation, clinical consequences of frameshift mutation, describe their types as well. And what is recombinant DNA technology, and what is the principle of recombinant DNA technology, and what are the applications of recombinant DNA technology in the modern medicine. Okay, so these are some of the highlights of this topic, and we're going to assemble again by 3 p.m. Thank you.